everyone. Welcome to DuBois Talk here on DuBois TV. My name's Cinnamon. I'm your host. And today we have an awesome episode ready. And we are actually going to be going on a little bit of an adventure at the depot right here in DuBois. But before we get to all of that, I want to thank all of our sponsors. The Clearfield Jefferson Drug and Alcohol Commission, Goodwill Industries of North Central Pennsylvania, the depot at Doolittle's, and Advanced Disposal.
Hello?
Ashley, you have to get here. My brother got us beer.
Come on, you know I don't drink. I'm getting ready for states.
Whatever.
Because of generous donors like you, we have been able to assist our communities in life challenges. Through opportunity, training, education, and work, Goodwill Industries of North Central Pennsylvania has been serving our region for 50 years and counting.
So like I said, in this episode of DuBois Talk, we are going to be highlighting our newest sponsor, the depot at Doolittle's. Now, if you've been around DuBois for any amount of time, I'm sure you already know where Doolittle's is. And if not, all you have to look for is a bunch of dinosaurs and some train cars. Now, we are going to be focusing on the train cars, but before we head down to the depot, I think it's important that we go back in time and really understand why these train cars are so special. So let's learn a little bit about the history of the railroad industry in DuBois.
Hi, I'm Todd Thompson. I'm the historian here at the DuBois Area Historical Society. Today we're going to give you a brief overview of the railroads in DuBois. John DuBois was the founder of DuBois. John came from DuBois Town, which was located north of Williamsport, Pennsylvania. He traveled out here when he was 67 years old, stopped in Luthersburg, left his horse there at the Golden Yoke, traveled from there by foot into DuBois, and was looking for land he could purchase that had timber on it. He ran into John Rumbarger and also ran into George Schaefer, who were here already. He started buying up land so he could start his mill here in DuBois. The Pennsylvania Railroad was the first railroad to come into DuBois, and it started in 1870. In fact, the first tunnel that was built in Sebula, and it was 1,900 feet long. It took 4 years for them to dig the tunnel. 1,900 feet, they dug it by pick and shovel and mule cart. The dirt or the remnants of the tunnel were used to build Lake Sebula. The first passenger train came to DuBois in 1873, and that was through the tunnel. John's lumbering operations started here in DuBois and became very prosperous, but it started to decrease in the 1880s. The biggest problem was they started running out of timber. By March of 1883, the first drift mine here in DuBois was started, and that was located in a 1,000-acre tract between here and Falls Creek, Pennsylvania. They needed a new railroad to haul the coal from that line, and that's when the BRMP came. So we had the passenger service on one end of town, which was over on the east side near the DuBois Mansion, but we also had the railroad on this end of town, which was the BRMP, that's the Buffalo, Rochester, and Pittsburgh. But another mine opened on the east side of town, and that was Berwyn and White Coal Company. They purchased 2,000 acres of coal, and they started, they put down a shaft right near the DuBois Mall, just to the north of the DuBois Mall. In 1900, it was taken over by the Buffalo and Susquehanna Coal and Coke Company, but the Buffalo and Susquehanna Coal and Coke Company was also a railroad. The railroads, of course, what they did was they were the ones that wanted to haul the coal and make their money, but they also wanted to own the coal interests too. The BNS, that's the Buffalo and Susquehanna, leased trackage rights from the BRMP. That means they were able to handle they could use their tracks. They leased the tracks from them so they could use that. From Sykesville to Punxsutawney is where the BNS ran. In 1904, the big lumbering mill gave its last toot, and the coal became the primary item that the railroads were hauling. So a lumbering town at one time now turned into a coal mining town. The BRMP, the Pensy or the Pennsylvania Railroad, and the BNS Railroad all had passenger service in DuBois, with more than 12 trains a day coming and leaving DuBois, north and south. I can remember as a young boy coming from Brockway over to DuBois, there were two northbound and two southbound trains. And with my older sisters, we'd get on a train in Brockway, we would ride to DuBois, they would shop, we'd stop at Nick's and get a hot dog on the way back, get back on the train and ride back to Brockway. I don't remember the cost of it, but it was probably the most thrilling thing there was to ride that train. In fact, even today when I go somewhere, I look for a train to ride. DuBois also had the Steam Locomotive Works, and it closed. The Steam Locomotive Works and the car shops were combined, and they employed more than 1,300 employees. The locomotive works closed with the advent of the diesel locomotive. The operations moved to Altoona. There was no longer need for steam locomotives at that time. But the car shops, they continued to operate clear into the 1960s. And that's where Rescar is today. And all of this is in sight of Dr. Rice's depot. So when you're at Dr. Rice's depot, if you look almost straight ahead, you can see where the yards were and where Rescar has the tank cars that they repair.
Now I think it's time to actually go down to the depot and take a look inside. Now when you think about what the depot is, a museum and two restaurants that are actually inside of two real train cars, you have to ask the question, who would think to do something this unique in this area? Well, the answer is Dr. Jeffery Rice, who's from DuBois. Now we sat down with him and he was gracious enough to let us pick his brain. So first of all, can you kind of just introduce yourself for people who don't know who you are? Can you introduce yourself and tell me what you do?
I'm Jeff Rice. I'm a oral maxillofacial surgeon. I've been around this area since 1980.
So you're also a collector, though.
I'm a collector.
You're a really big-time collector.
Avid collector.
Yes, you're an avid collector. Can you tell me what sparked your interest in collecting things? In general, I've
always liked collecting things. I like beautiful things, unusual things, historically interesting things. It's just part of me. Problem is, I tend to go to extremes at times.
It really seems like you do. Can you talk a little bit about the extremes that you've gone into collecting? Like, specifically, what kinds of things have you collected?
Whole variety. Some of my biggest collections. Downtown is the Winkler Gallery. I have a collection of carousel animals, carousel horses. Now, I rode a carousel horse when I was a kid. I really enjoyed it. So now I got a carousel and multiple horses, and I want to share it with the public at the gallery. It's open to the public, and it's a piece of history. And also, I really want to bring tourism to the town. It's a good, clean industry. And people need to know about history, need to know about things of the past. And I'm an avid collector and to extreme, so you can go down there and see a whole carousel from the 1890s to multiple carousel animals.
It seems like you collect, there's no rhyme or reason to the kinds of things that you find yourself interested in. I was sitting in the lobby, the waiting room of your doctor's office, and there's a collection of butterflies on the wall. It just seems like it's just anything that sparks your interest for a second, you just buy all of them.
It goes back to my childhood. I collected butterflies when I was a kid. And I guess the older I've gotten, the more of a kid I've become. It's just bigger toys and bigger collections.
So speaking of toys, we are sitting at a, people probably don't know why we're sitting at a dining table right now, but we are actually at the depot. We're in a train car, and can you just tell me a little bit about what the depot is and why you created it?
Well, actually, you're sitting in part of my train set. I had a little one I used to get for Christmas, and when I was a kid, I always wanted a caboose. So my whole life, I wanted a caboose, so I bought a caboose, and I tend to go to extremes, and I may have gone to extremes in this case. I love trains. I love the history of it. This area was really rich in railroad history, which was being lost. A lot of people really don't know that DuBois was one of the railroad hubs, the shops that made the cars. And again, to bring tourism to the area, a good clean industry, and I like to share my passion with others. So I started with the caboose, and then I always wanted a rail car to go with the caboose, so you're sitting in it. This is a 1913 parlor car. Relatively original, a very rare one that I found, restored, and for good use, I decided to put it into a dining room so people can come in for elegant dining. It's just like they go back to 1913 when the car was built. People would come in the car and eat, so you can return to 1913. I have another. For those that like the 50s, another rail car that was made in the 40s to be a 50s diner. The prize I got that came in is a car that's original interior of a 1901 Pullman that was custom built for the president of a railroad. And that car in that day was today's Learjet.
How are you finding these things? How do you come across these things? Are you looking for them? It seems like things just pop up in your life.
It's like this. The internet is dangerous.
But these aren't things you're finding on Amazon.
No, Amazon.
You can't buy trains on Amazon.
Amazon Prime does not have a train yet. Maybe someday, but sometimes they find me. And they people realize there's an eccentric dock in DuBois that crazy enough to buy these things. The 1901 is so historically significant. The interior is one of the best original interiors in the United States. I've had people from the museum come look at it. They've been amazed. But it was built for the president of a railroad, just used for his pleasure. And the interesting history was that Teddy Roosevelt used it for one of his excursions, gave a speech, and I actually found the speech that he gave on the Teddy Roosevelt site. But it's unbelievable history, and there are so many railroad nuts, or I'm allowed to
you,
say that.
Yeah, you are allowed to say. You say whatever you want about people who obsess over railroads.
Yeah. It will really bring in people, probably from all over the country that pass through on 80 to DuBois, and this little, hopefully, depot, which I tried to bring in a railroad depot. I found a beautiful one I wanted to bring in, but I ran into a handicap. It's called Building Inspector. It couldn't, even though it stood for over 100 years, it was sound. It could not pass the new railroad codes or the new codes for building, so I had to build my own.
So you had to build your own.
I got blueprints. I was not going to let that stand in my way, so these rail cars are now connected to a reproduction rail station, which is very accurate. It's either old material or exact reproduction, which...
And it's amazing. Everything looks amazing.
I went to extremes.
Yeah.
Once again.
Yeah.
So it was going to be a museum, so it's filled with artifacts, both of this area and areas surrounding, but so many things happen in railroad history that people don't know about. People don't know about the massive train wreck in 1893, the second biggest circus train wreck in United States history. So I got the original photos so people can come see pieces of history, parts of the B&O plant here that produced the rail cars, produced the steam engines, and they can come see pictures of train wrecks, which people don't realize how many people die by rail. The average death rate turn of the century was 9,000 people a year.
It seems like if you find an interest in something, you have to know, you have to have all of it, and you have to know all of it, and you just have to share it with everybody.
Like I say, goes to extremes.
Yeah, we could just keep saying that over and over again. Well, thank you so much for sharing with me today. And I have to say that you really, I'll stand by this, have to be one of the most interesting people, if not the most interesting person in our area, by far.
Well, one of the more eccentric.
Eccentric, yeah.
But at least I'm accepted.
Yes.
And I got a lot
of... accept you, and we keep a... Yeah. I think a lot of people keep a close eye on what you're doing because we all want to be a part of it.
Yeah, I got a lot of other plans, but I need to live to be about 150, so I'll work on that.
So after talking with Dr. Rice, even for just a small amount of time, I quickly realized that he's one of the most fascinating people that I've ever met. He's definitely a visionary and he has his eyes on a big picture. But he has people around him who are focusing on the details for him. So we sat down with Tara, who's the head chef at the Depot.
Well, I like to see people when they first come in the door because they don't expect the Depot lobby to be what it is, because it's built around the creamery and the trains are built into them, and from the outside you can't tell what it's going to be. So when you come in and you see the grand space and the light fixtures from the period, you know, that's the point that I like to see people, because they're always, it's always the same reaction. Wow, I had no idea this was here. And that was my reaction the first time I walked in. The Depot encompasses three different things. We have a rail museum is in our lobby, and then we also have the diner car at the Depot, which is a diner operating out of a 1940s Pullman train car, and the parlor car at the Depot, which is a 1913s parlor train car that we have our fine dining in on the weekends. Well, I think the Depot's food's different. We're updating the menu, we call it New American food. I have a lot of vegetarian options, gluten-free options for diners looking for different foods than they can get at other restaurants, similar restaurants. We also do a lot of farm-to-table. I use local purveyors. I have a woman in Brockport that brings me vegetables every week and eggs, and I try to, you know, get as much local involvement as possible. Well, the intention for the Depot and Dr. Rice's intention is to have two things, to have a fine dining for a small town. So we have a very small train, it can fit 34 people. So our weekly open Friday and Saturday nights, and I get seafood flown in on Fridays that, you know, it feels like a meal that you could have in Pittsburgh, and it's, you know, a special occasion. Other purpose of the Depot specifically, and the rail museum and the train cars, is to preserve the rail path of the area, because that's going away and not a lot of places have anywhere for the memorabilia to be kept, so it ties people together, like we were talking about, like the older generation with the younger generation. A lot of people come here and they've never been on a train, which 50 years ago people would have probably ridden on passenger trains quite a bit more. So that was his intention, is to preserve the rail history. So I think that the Depot and the parlor car specifically creates an environment for people to share the past and share parts of themselves that they might not necessarily do if they were in, you know, a different environment. So we had a gentleman celebrate his 103rd birthday with us, which was a great thing just to begin with. But he told a story along the way about his life and how he had ridden on a train car, and he had had a conversation with a man, and, you know, they had a nice chat. And then when the gentleman got up to leave, he said, "Henry Ford, it's been nice chatting with you," and he left the train. So, he told that story to the staff and to his family, and the rail car is what brought that all together. So it's very interesting and nice that people can share that space and share that with us.
So after talking with Tara, I decided that I really needed to experience dining at the Depot firsthand. So I told my husband about it, and we made it a date night. Hi, everyone. everyone. So I'm sitting here at the depot in the parlor car, and I'm really excited because this is the first time I'm going to actually get to taste the food that's served here in the parlor car. So I'm here actually on a date. I'm here to have dinner with my husband. This is my husband, Mike, and we have just ordered, we have our water, but we have nothing else. So we ordered our food, and what did you order for dinner tonight?
I went with the grass-fed filet mignon with red wine reduction, local Swiss chard, and salt-roasted potatoes.
You didn't get far in the menu. That's the first thing he saw.
It sounded really good.
In the menu, and he chose that. I chose the Mongolian grilled pork belly chop with grilled squash and mustard sauce, and I was told it looks really big when you get it. It's like a big pile of food, and I'm starving, so that's probably why I went with that. That's awesome. Thank you. That looks so cool.
That looks so good.
That looks awesome. Thank you. All right. So, look at that. That looks so awesome. It's really, really good. I was actually worried because I don't like my food to be tough, ever. And I kind of thought this was going to be kind of a hard thing. And I was very glad to figure out that it's actually super, the pork is perfect. It's like crispy on the outside and it's like super tender on the inside. So that's exactly how I like it. So they know how to do it.
Yeah, and this was really awesome. The beets and the balsamic vinegar were kind of like tart, and it just went like really nice with like the goat cheese that's in there is really smooth and creamy, and it's just, it was awesome.
So I'm really excited because this is, I've never seen anything like this, and so far the food is awesome and it's really creative, and that's something that I'm really impressed with. And this is just the appetizers. Oh, I'm really excited. That looks super juicy and tender.
It smells so good.
That's awesome. All right, thank you. So, once again, I'm like super impressed with the creativity of it. I just like that and how a plate looks before I even get a taste of it. And I really, really appreciate that my squash turned into stars. I can't think of a better shape for squash to be. Okay, well, we are wrapping up dinner, and we are both pretty full, but full with really, really good food. I think we're both extremely happy with the things that we've ordered, and I thought it was going to be good. I did not know that it was going to be this good, and not only was the food good, but it looked good on a plate, and everything looked beautiful, and it looked so pretty, and seriously, I'm from now on not going to eat any sort of squash that's not shaped like a star, because I think that was the key, because the squash was just the best squash I've ever had, and it was a star. So, but anyway, everything else was really good too, and it looked good, but all together, being in a train car with good food that looked good on the plate was such a cool experience, and to have a place like this in our community is super special, and I just really see why people come from all around the United States, and I know what will happen is the world, to come and sit here and eat in a train car that has actually at one point been on a railroad traveling someplace. That's exactly what it feels like here, and it's just really cool. Now, before we go to the next segment, I just want to say just one more time that the food at the depot was awesome and Tara is amazing. So this next segment was not planned at all. We didn't even ask because we didn't think it would be allowed. But Dr. Rice actually gave us a private tour of the newest train car at the depot, the Roosevelt car. This car is not even open to the public yet, so here is a sneak peek.
This is original. This is, in fact, under this cloth is the table that Teddy Roosevelt ate at.
So when people come and they're going to eat?
What this car will be, it will be a semi-museum.
Oh, okay.
And it will be kind of like a bed and breakfast.
Okay.
If you've always wanted to sleep in a 1901 Pullman car.
Yeah.
And see what it was like back over 100 years ago.
For Teddy Roosevelt.
Yeah. You can sleep in the bed that Teddy Roosevelt slept in.
You can sleep in the bed that Teddy Roosevelt slept in.
Same bed. In fact, his chair is still back there.
Really? Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness, that's amazing. It seems like you keep just accumulating train cars. Is it easy to get train cars here?
No, this was a challenging one. I looked at it for couple years it was for sale. They finally auctioned it off. The problem was when it was moved to a resort area in Wisconsin, they built part of a house around it. So
they built a house around it?
Around it.
Okay.
The rail car, unfortunately, was in the back of the house, and they built the house in front. So it was a vacation home. Used very, very little. Now the problem is, who would want to buy a house with a rail car sticking in it?
Yeah.
Me.
You
and
know.
One other person, so only two of us bid at the auction. No one had wanted to buy it because they figured there was no feasible way to extract that rail car from the house, but I purchased it. It took about a year to get the whole thing together. To get it out, they had to demolish part of the house.
Okay.
And unfortunately, 50 years ago, they planted trees around it. And 50 years of tree growth, we had to cut the trees. So the trees were removed back
then. You really wanted this?
I wanted this.
Here?
Here.
That's amazing.
The thing is, I bought a sight unseen. I didn't see it till it appeared.
Really?
I saw photos. And I was hoping those were real photos.
Yeah, well, I bet. And now, what do you plan on going back to this house, or what? Where's the house that the train?
The house is in Wisconsin.
Okay, and
if anyone wants to buy half a house and a property, it's near a resort.
So that's half a house in Wisconsin. If anyone's interested,
it's for sale. A good deal.
It's for sale. Yeah,
we'll
give you a good price.
We'll have a fire sale.
Yeah. Okay.
We'll do it half price.
Okay. Yeah, you get it half price. Half a house at half price.
But it got rerouted. It got trucked down here by truck. Smith Hauling, unbelievably good company from Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania.
Okay.
Did the hauling. I mean, they were the only ones with the guts to get it out. The back, part of it was put on a dolly, part of it was put on the truck in front. And the weight of it weighs about 190,000 pounds.
Wow.
It started to bow a little bit in the middle, so they had to leave Wisconsin to come back to Punxsutawney, get their truck altered, more wheels put under, then went back, hauled it out.
Wow.
This was where Teddy Roosevelt slept, or not slept. He might have slept in the chair. I do when I get home. I'm exhausted. Have a seat.
Wow, this is really, really cool. This is like goosebumpy.
It's horsehair filled. That's the original upholstery.
Wow.
The whole thing's from 1901.
Wow.
So you sat where a famous man sat.
Yeah. Well, that's the end of our episode. I hope you enjoyed hearing from Dr. Rice and getting a video tour of the depot, but please stop down because it's even better in person. So before we go, I want to thank our sponsors just one more time. The Clearfield Jefferson Drug and Alcohol Commission, Goodwill Industries of North Central Pennsylvania, The Depot at Doolittle's, and Advanced Disposal. Thanks for watching, everyone. We'll see you next time.